Dear colleagues, organizers, it's a pleasure for me to also present and continue on Beate's presentation, more focused on hydromorphological pressures and progress in implementing measures and river restoration. As Beate presented, we are on more than halfway through the first river basin management plans. We had the first reporting of the status, the pressures, the program of measures in the first river basin management plans, and then we had the progress reporting by December 2012, and we are looking forward to the second river basin management plans. So my presentations will try to provide an overview of the hydromorphological pressures in the first river basin management plans, how it went with the progress in implementing, and what is the challenges for the second river basin management plans. As Beate explained, we are an arm's length agency compared to the commissions, but we work closely together. So we manage the water information system for Europe, so we, when member states reported their 160-70 river-based management plans in the first phase, we were handling, or together with the commissions, consultant handling all the data and trying to provide European overview of what was the status, what was the pressure affecting European waters. And this included the overview of what is the actually hydromorphological pressures that are causing altered habitats and affecting the ecological status. For us, it's the barriers, the transverse structures in all European rivers. It's all the morphological changes, but it's also the pressures affecting the hydrology, water abstraction, flow regulations, and so on. In my presentation, I try to say, put the linkage with river restoration, because actually it's where we need river restoration to mitigate all these pressures. So if we can illustrate how far we get with implementing the program of measures in the river basin management plans in relation to hydromorphological pressures, we can also partly indicate how far we are integrating river restoration in river management of European rivers. Another way of illustrating Beate's slide then focused more on the hydromorphological pressures. We have a lot of sector activities affecting waters and resulting either in barriers, in flow regulations, in sediment dredging, sediment removal, morphological changes, and then resulting in habitat alterations and therefore needs to improve their status. The results from the first river basin management plans and indicated that hydromorphological pressures are affecting more than 45% of the European river water bodies. It was so that when member states reported their river basin management plan, it was 104,000 river water bodies, or comparable to splitting all European rivers up in 11 kilometers stretches. And 45% of those, or around 45,000, was affected by hydromorphological pressures. What does it actually mean that a water body is affected by hydromorphological pressure? It is indicating that this water body is at risk of not achieving good or high ecological status because of these hydromorphological pressures. So it was the way we translated the characterization of pressures in the river-based management plans, that a water body being affected by hydromorphological pressures, then it was either in moderate, poor, or bad status because of these pressures. A water body could, of course, be affected by other pressures like diffuse pollution, and you can also see here more than 40% of European rivers was affected by diffuse pollution, or 25% being affected by point source pollution, and also some being affected by water abstraction. This is the map comparable to the map Beate showed on ecological status, because this actually shows the proportion of water bodies being affected by hydromorphological pressure. So we can see in Central Europe, more than 70, or in some cases more than 90% of all the river water bodies in the river basin districts are affected by hydromorphological pressures. But you can also see on the map in more sparsely populated river basin districts like Scotland or northern Sweden, 30 to 50% of the river water bodies was affected by hydromorphological pressures. So it's all these pressures, and most of my photos illustrate barriers because it's the most simple to illustrate. It's more difficult to illustrate morphology, but of course morphology also has changed a lot, and also the hydrology. It's all these impacts in detail illustrated by these barriers, either small barriers like the one in the left corner, weirs, or the, some smaller hydropower plants here. And during our assessments, we indicated that at least European rivers are affected by several hundred thousand barriers. And if I should give my best estimate, it's 1 million barriers in European rivers. We based our assessment on a number of national inventories, surveys. France indicated they had 120,000 transverse structures, or Germany indicates 200,000 or every second kilometers in their river network. Austria, 33,000 barriers in their identified water bodies for the Water Framework Directive, or every kilometer. I took this figure of maybe 1 million barriers as an indication, because I think many of us here would be happy if the first river basin management plans make 10,000 of the barriers passable. I think it will be a big number. 50,000 of the could also be a number made passable during the first river basin management plans. But then compared to 1 million, then it will take either 100 years or 20 years to make all of them. No, it will take, if it's only 10,000 in the first river basin management plan, it will take 100 river basin management planning periods of 6 years, so 600 years. Or if it's 50,000 in the first, then it will be also more than 100 years before we have made them all passable. Of course, the hydromorphological pressure was not only the barriers. Here I took from the Austrian characterization of the risk of not achieving good status, took the hydromorphological pressures in, and it was just coming out here in 2014, and it compares their characterization in 2009 and 2013. And the green one indicates water bodies not at risk, the yellow one possible at risk, and the red one at risk. And you can see for the three ones, the three first ones, the hydro peaking, the dry river stretches, and the storage reservoirs, they are affecting 5 to 20% of the Austrian river water bodies. But knowing that there is 7,000 Austrian river water bodies, 5% is also a large number. Then the structural changes, the morphology changes to river stretches is around 20 to 30%, and the barriers 50 to 40%. And to take two other examples, two Spanish river basin districts in Duero, 3,600 barriers, or in Dominio Limnio, 2,200, higher than 2 meters. In the Duero, 1,100 channelized sections, or 600 bank enforcements. Or in Sweden, there is around 2,000 hydropower plants. Everyone, nearly all of them, has storage reservoirs. There's 5,000 other dams, and there's 200,000 road crossings, and the Swedes estimate that every third of them act as a barrier. So one third of 200,000, 60,000 barriers in due to road crossings, many affected by regulators for timber floating 30, 50 years or 70 years ago. As Beate also said, it was really difficult and a challenge to get an overview of the measures, the program of measures in the first river basin management plans. That there could be many reasons. Maybe there was a lot of uncertainty on the funding, on the actually what was the need of the measures. This one illustrates the measures in the first river basin management plan. Below you find the dark green color. That around 60% of the river basin management plans had measure on mitigation of barriers. We would expect it would be 100% of the river basin management plans. The yellow one is the renaturation, connecting rivers to the floodplains, remeandering, and so on. Also, around 50% of the river basin management plan had these measures. The light green one is the sediment management, a little bit below or around 50%. Then there is natural water retention measures, around 20 to 30%, and ecological flow also around one third of the river basin districts. Going also in a little bit more concrete, taking two examples. Actually, Denmark has withdrawn its first river basin management plans, but these figures here indicate the need for hydromorphological measures or river restoration measures. In the Danish network reported under WFD or in the river basin management plan on 22,000 kilometers, there was a need for changing river maintenance for 9,500 kilometers. There was physical in-stream improvement for 7,000 kilometers, or opening of covered streams 2,700 kilometers, or making or remove or making them passable nearly 3,000. In the Dutch river basin management plans, and now it's the plan for the first river basin management period, they were planning to having 1,700 nature-friendly banks on standing waters, 800 kilometers of nature-friendly banks on flowing waters, or remeandering streams, making room for the rivers, resulting in 1,100 hectares, or removing or making 600 structures passable for fish or aquatic. So it's all these, again, illustrating barriers, but also morphological changed urban rivers. All these measures has to affect. Then in December 2012, member states reported the progress in implementing the measures. And here again, as you already have seen from the first part of my presentation, it's really difficult to compare all these apples and pears and measures and different, some of our barriers, and a measure can be a simple spreading some gravel for spawning, but it can also be removing or making a big dam passable. So how to compare it all? But as indicated also in Beate's presentation, the ambition was relatively low in the first river basin management plan. And if we are even lower in when we compare the progress in 2012, then we may be being far from reaching the objective, which is not requiring, but aiming at having all water bodies at good status in 2015. When member states reported in December 2012, they reported partly by key types of measures. There was three key types of measures covering the hydromorphological measures, the number five on improving the longitudinal continuity, establishing fish passes or demolishing old dams. The second one on the other, or actually most of the other hydromorphological measures except the longitudinal continuity. river restoration, improving riparian areas, buffer strips, and so on, hard embankments, reconnecting to floodplains. And then number seven was improving the hydrological conditions, the flow regime, hydro peaking, establishing minimum flows. All this will, the Commission is working on a report and a communication which will be published in March next year on the progress of Member States implementing of the measures in December 2012. So I present some of the preliminary results, and it's illustrated by the red ones was measures that by the end of 2012 was not started. The yellow one was planning ongoing, and the orange ones was construction ongoing, and the green ones were completed. And then member state also had different options. They could either report if they expected the total cost would be 100 million euro over the period on implement and measures on improving longitudinal continuity, then they could estimate how far there was in spending the money, or they could count the number of projects, measures to improve the longitudinal continuity. If we take the positive side, there is some green and orange ones, and that has been happening a lot, and I think it's important to say that the Water Framework Directive and the River Based Management Plan started a lot of activities and are acting on a lot of activities. If we then look on the negative side, the yellow and the red one, there's many activities 3 years after the River Based Management Plans, which was not yet started. There's many where there's only ongoing planning, and of course they will have difficulties being implemented during the first river basin cycle. Similar on improving the longitude or the other morphological measures, you see a more or less similar picture. Again, there was different ways of counting the progress in implementing measures. There is some green and orange ones, but there's also many red and yellow ones. We take one example. Germany expected during the first river basin management period to implement 3,500 measures on improving the longitudinal continuity and 13,000 measures on other morphological measures. And you can see there is around 30% of the improving the longitudinal continuity, which is either completed or the construction is ongoing. Then there's a lot of in planning and lot not started, and similar on the other 13,000. There's also many barriers for actually implementing this, and the Germans indicated and have this diagram, and now it's actually counting all the program measures for Germany, both the pollution and the hydromorphological measures. Three quarters of them is actually on track and being implemented as foreseen in the first river based management plan. And then there's one quarter or 24% which are substantially delayed. And the Germans also indicate what is the substantial delay in implementing them. It's either obtaining financial or personal resources, affecting up to 7,000 measures. It's opposition of the envisaged measure affecting 5,000 measures, and problems with obtaining the necessary land affecting 4,000 measures. Yeah. So there is a chance that actually I think if we look on the positive side, we have started a process with the first river-based management plans. We have described a lot of measures to be implemented, and there is start and there is happening a lot. I think to go back to one of Beate's slides, there is really at the moment for coordinating the different policies. We have the river basin, the water framework directive, and the river basin management plans, with the objective of achieving good ecological status. We have the flood directives, of where we include natural for flood management in. We have the habitat directive of good conservation status, and we have this biodiversity strategy restoration target, and we have climate change adaptation. All these policies require a program of measure or conservation plans, require green infrastructure, natural water retention measures, adaptation measures. And if we look also on the possibilities of getting EU funding or partly funding of it, when the Common Agricultural Policy was revised here in 13, the rural development plans, which are the soft part of the Common Agricultural Policy, made clear reference that water measures in rural development plans has to relate to achieve the objectives of the Water Framework Directive. On the European Marine and Fisheries Funds, it's also clear requirements that achieving the objectives of the Water Framework Directive. So there is a clear funding and coordinating, and my hope is that we can have a coordinated measures based on a catchment river basin approach, ensuring the multiple benefits for the different policies, and also being able to prioritize the measures. Again, I think one of the reading a lot of river basin management plans, also the drafts ones coming out now and other documents, I think the first river basin management plans was initiator or a primer of a lot of national programs, strategies for having funding for implementing hydromorphological measures. And I think we'll hear later on the catchment restoration fund as a good example. I could see a session on the next river restoration conference where we took all these national funding or strategies for implementing these, presenting their objectives, their what they have achieved, that could be really relevant. And then to the last slide. We are moving towards the next river basin management cycles. It was a challenge to handle the information on hydromorphological pressure and measures in the first river basin management plans. We have tried, together with the Commission, with member states, to improve the reporting next time. So it will be much more specific. We're not talking about a generalized term like hydromorphological pressures, but being much more specific. So there is a hope with the next river-based management plans being reported that we have much more better data, better overviews. There is also hope that we, in the next river-based management plans, will have a better linkage of pressure, status, and measures. So we can answer the questions, are the measures identified sufficient to achieve good status? I think in the future there is an urgent need for this coordination of measures between the nature directives and the WFD. In December, there is a workshop with the water directives and the nature directives meeting to discuss good international examples and so on. But I think we have to move to a converge where we try to implement it. And then the last one, if we can get river restoration or as part of the documentation of how member state has implemented this target of restoring the restoration target of 15% of the degraded ecosystem has to be improved, then I think it will be a really good starting or good push for having much more river restoration at national level, much more funding. And I think river restoration would be one of the good areas where we can document if we are achieving this 15% restoration target. Thank you.